of this. Do you have anything here that you are curious about with these charts?
Not at this time.
Just listening? Okay. Well, this is a school and it's not a church, and we do come here to learn about our Creator, and we use His true original name that was given to Moses at the burning bush. And that name that was given, and I will prove it to you, is Yahweh. That is the true name of the Creator of the universe. But before we go there, can I just get Hebrews 4 and 12, John 17 and 3, and Luke 24 and 27.
Hebrews 4 and 3.
4 and 12?
4 and 12.
Mm-hmm.
Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living Elohim.
That's not exactly what I wanted, but
that's because it's not the one.
Okay, but I liked it.
Hebrews 4 and 12.
Okay.
For the word of Yahweh is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword.
So the word of Yahweh, or the word of Yahweh, is powerful and quicker than any two-edged sword. And go ahead and get Luke 24 and 27 and Isaiah 8 and 20.
Finish.
Okay, you want to finish? Okay.
Piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart.
So it is powerful. The word of Yahweh is powerful and it's able to discern the thoughts of men, okay? But go ahead and get Luke 24 and 27 and Isaiah 8 and 20.
Luke 24 and 27.
Mm-hmm.
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Now, Dr. Tina Pettigrew just went through this on Sunday, and it was very good because she went all the way back to Luke, the 24th chapter, beginning at 1, and she explained how we got to this point. But I'm going to shorten it just for today because we have to get into other things. But basically what's happening is Yahshua, or what the world calls Jesus, he's walking on the road to Emmaus. And he is beginning at Moses and all the prophets in order to explain something to the people or the disciples that he's walking with, or the apostles. So this scripture is saying to the law, or you might say, what's the law? The law is the first five books of the Bible. So Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So he began at the law. And then he also went to the testimony, or to the prophets. The prophets wrote the testimony. So Jeremiah wrote, Isaiah wrote, Ezekiel wrote, to the law and to the prophets. That's Joshua through Malachi. If they speak what?
Not according to this word.
If they speak not according to this word. So they can't speak according to a tarot reading. They can't speak according to some type of dice. What is it?
Astrology.
Which, yeah. You can't speak according to that. That's not how you're going to get to Yahweh or the Lord, what people call the Lord. There's a precise method for getting to know him. So he's beginning at the law, to the law, and to the testimony. Read on.
If they speak not according to this word.
If they speak not according to this word or this Bible. Read on.
It is because there is no light in them.
It is because there is no light in them. So they don't understand. Understanding is synonymous with light. Isaiah 8 and 20.
To the law and to the testimony.
Mm-hmm.
If they speak not according to this word.
Now, Isaiah is saying the same thing. So what you'll find out when you read from Genesis to Revelation, what you're going to find out is that the Bible actually confirms itself. So Isaiah is saying the same thing that we just read, what the world calls Jesus. His real name is Joshua. We'll get to that. He's saying the same thing in Isaiah. To the law and to the testimony, read on.
If they speak not according to this word.
If they speak not according to this word, read on.
It is because there is no light in them.
It is because there is no light in them. Did you get Luke 24 and 27? Okay, because it sounded like it was the same thing. But basically, it is the same thing. Mm-hmm. To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, is it because there's no light in them? So what we're going to do in this class is we're going to go back to the Bible, to the law, and to the testimony to show you something about the Creator. So go ahead and get John 17 and 3.
You want me to start at 1 or at 3?
You can start at 1. That's
all right.
Fine.
John 17 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
These words spake Yahshua.
Now, can you do me a favor? And just for now, can you read it out of the, as a King James?
Sure.
Out of the King James Version. So what he's going to do is he's going to read it the way we see it in the King James Version. Okay? So go ahead.
These words spake Jesus.
So these words spake Jesus. Or the true name, these words spake Yahshua, read on.
And lifted up his eyes to heaven.
And he lifted up his eyes to heaven, read on.
And said, Father, the hour is come.
He said to his father, the hour is come, read on.
Glorify thy son.
Now he said, glorify thy son, read on.
That thy son also may glorify
that
thee.
That thy son also may glorify thee, read on.
As thou hast given him power over all flesh.
Now you, Yahweh, or the Lord, gave power to Jesus over all flesh, read on.
That he should give eternal life.
That he, Yahshua, or Jesus Christ, read on, should give eternal life, read on.
To as many as thou hast given him.
To as many as the Father has given him, read on.
And this is life eternal.
Now, what we're going to find out is how to get to heaven. That's what this next verse is going to explain. How do you even get to heaven? So it's saying it's going to give you a definition of life eternal. Or of heaven. So life eternal, read on.
And this is life eternal.
And this is life eternal, or this is heaven, or this is life after death, read on.
That they might know thee.
That they, anyone, might know thee, read on.
The only true God.
Who's the only true God, read on.
And Jesus Christ.
And Jesus Christ, read on.
Whom thou hast sent.
Whom thou, the Father, or what people call the Lord for now, has sent. Okay, is that all we've got there?
That's three, yep.
Okay, so perfect. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go to Moses, and we're going to read where Moses met the Creator for the first time. So go ahead for me and pick it up at 1 and about 11, I'd say. Uh-huh. 1 and 11.
Exodus 1 and 11.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens.
So maybe 9. Go up to the train of thought.
And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than
maybe
we.
Maybe 7?
You want
8? 7 or 8, like around
8.
There.
Yeah. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which
okay.
knew not Joseph.
So there's a new king that's going to arise up down here in Egypt, and he knew not Joseph. Because if you know the story of Joseph, Joseph was up here in Canaan land, and he was sold by his brethren down into bondage. So he ended up being in Egypt, and because Joseph could interpret Pharaoh's dream, that's how they got wealth down in Egypt. So now there's a king that arose that knew not Joseph. Okay, so read on.
And he said unto his people, mm-hmm. this is 9, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier
so
than we.
So he's fearful. So this Pharaoh or this king is fearful, and he's saying that the children of Israel are becoming to be more and mightier than us. Read on.
Come on, let us deal wisely with them.
Now he said, let us deal wisely with them. Read on.
Lest they multiply, and it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us.
So he understood that he was treating them rotten, very poorly, that they were in bondage, and he feared because of his own condemnation that they would join with other nations and basically destroy them. So now he's going to do something about that problem. Okay, read on.
And so get them up out of the land.
So he's saying get them up out of the land. So the king is saying to get this. Look, the king doesn't even understand how he got his own wealth. He got his own wealth because Yahweh Elohim gave one of his men a gift of interpretation. That's how Pharaoh got rich, but he doesn't understand that. So he's trying to kill these people. Okay, read on.
Therefore, they did set over them taskmasters.
So he's going to set over them taskmasters, or what we would call in this modern society, like managers, supervisors, somebody to watch over you. Read on.
To afflict them with their burdens.
Now, to afflict them with their burdens. Read on.
And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses.
So they're building down here, the children of Israel are building treasure cities. So, you know, it's treasure cities. It's not like a building with a, you know, like we have Fort Knox, okay, which there's probably no gold in there if you do the research. But they're building treasure cities. So like this Lansing would be a city full of treasure. So diamonds and rubies and, you know, all types of whatever was treasure, gold, silver. Treasure cities are being built by Yahweh's people in the land of Egypt. Read on.
But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew.
So the more they afflicted them, the children of Israel, the more they grew. Read on.
And they were grieved because of the children of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor.
Read on.
And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage.
So it was hard for them. Read on.
In mortar and mm-hmm. in brick mm-hmm. and in all manner of service in the field. All their service, wherein they made them serve, was with rigor.
Mm-hmm.
And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one was Shiprah, and the name of the other Puah.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, when ye do the office of a midwife to them of mm-hmm. the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools,
mm-hmm.
if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live.
Okay, so you have these midwives, and their office or their duties or their job title is to deliver babies. That's what a midwife does. But Pharaoh is directly telling them, if you see a male baby, we want you to throw it into the river. But if you have a female baby, then we want you to save it alive. Okay, read on.
But the midwives feared, you want King James or...
Yeah, go ahead and keep reading out of King James.
Okay, but the midwives feared God.
So the midwives, they feared God or Elohim. Read on.
And did not as the king of Egypt commanded them.
But they did not as the king commanded them. They saw behind the physical. They saw the spiritual realm. And they were not about to take part in that death. Okay, read on.
But saved the men children alive.
So they saved the men children alive. Read on.
And the king of Egypt called for the midwives mm-hmm. and said unto them, why have ye done this thing and have saved the men children alive?
Mm-hmm.
And the midwives said unto Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are lively. And our delivered ere the midwives come in unto them.
So Pharaoh's asking them, why are they still multiplying? And they're like, oh, well, the Hebrew women, they are too fast. We can't catch it. No, I don't think that was true. But they did what they had to do to survive and save life. Mm-hmm. Kind of like Schindler's List. Okay? Mm-hmm. Read on.
Therefore, Elohim, or God, dealt well with the midwives.
So Yahweh Elohim dealt well with the midwives. Read on.
And the people multiplied mm-hmm. and waxed very mighty.
So they keep multiplying and they're mighty. Read on.
And it came to pass, because the midwives feared God,
mm-hmm.
that he made them houses.
So the midwives feared Elohim and he made them houses. Read on.
And Pharaoh charged all his people, saying, mm-hmm. every son that is born ye shall cast into the river, and every daughter ye shall save alive.
Okay, so first Pharaoh only told the midwives, and he did it in secret. Now he's coming out on all the people, and he's saying, you know what? Everybody, if you see a male baby, throw him into the river. Okay, read on.
2 and 1.
Perfect.
And there went a man of the house of Levi and took to wife a daughter of Levi.
Mm-hmm.
And the woman conceived and bare a son.
Mm-hmm.
And when she saw him, that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months.
Okay, so Moses is being born. Now, Moses is a big player. Moses is the one who wrote Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. He's a big prophet, if you will, except for Yahweh didn't really call him a prophet. But Moses is a big player. So this is the birth of Moses. Now he's born under a death decree. His mother hides him for 3 months. When she can't hide him any longer, she builds for him an ark of bulrushes. She dabs it with slime and with pitch. And then she puts Moses in the ark. Read on.
And when she could not longer hide him,
mm-hmm.
she took for him an ark of bulrushes and daubed it with slime and with pitch
mm-hmm.
and put the child therein.
Mm-hmm.
And she laid it in the flags by the river's brink.
So she takes Moses, or actually Moses' sister does this. She lays Moses in the flags by the river's brink. Now, people were talking about, we just saw the Ten Commandments. On the movie, The Ten Commandments, they have that little baby floating down the river. And they actually literally have to go and grab him out of the river. That is not how Yahweh does things. He's trying to save Moses' life. So what he actually does is he takes the baby and he sets him by big rocks or big flag stones, weeds. So he's hidden by the river, by the river's brink. Okay, read on.
And his sister stood afar off to what would be done to him.
So his sister stands afar off to see what would be done to him. Read on.
And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river.
Mm-hmm.
And her maidens walked along by the river's side.
Okay, so Pharaoh's daughter is walking along the side of the river. Okay, read on.
And when she saw the ark among the flags,
mm-hmm.
she sent her maid to fetch it.
So she sends her maid to fetch it. Read on.
And when she opened it, she saw the child.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, the babe wept.
Mm-hmm.
And she had compassion on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children."
Okay, so Pharaoh's daughter, who has been given the death decree also, and we're going to know that she knows that Moses is a Hebrew, she sees Moses and has compassion. I was just thinking about this, how cute Moses probably was as a baby. But she has compassion, and you can't help it. When you see a little baby cry, they're so cute. I'm going through a phase where I'm starting to like babies, like a lot. And, oh, I know, it's terrible. But there's something in you, especially when you get to a certain age, where babies just are so adorable. So when she sees Moses, she can't kill it. Even though her father is a monster, she cannot conform to those attributes at that moment. So she is having compassion on the one that she's supposed to put to death. Read on.
Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter,
mm-hmm.
"Shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women,
mm-hmm.
that she may nurse the child for
okay.
thee?"
Read on.
And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." Mm-hmm. And the maid went and called the child's mother.
Okay, read on.
And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, "Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages." And the woman took the child and nursed it.
So Pharaoh's daughter ends up nursing. I'm sorry, Moses's real mother ends up nursing Moses and being paid by Pharaoh's daughter. So this is a divine setup that was set up from the foundation of the earth, from Yahweh Elohim. So Moses here is being protected, even though he was born under a death decree by Yahweh Elohim. Okay, so keep reading.
And the child grew,
mm-hmm.
and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter,
mm-hmm.
and he became her son.
So now she's adopted him into the family of Satan. I mean, literally. Pharaoh's house, he was of the satanic lineage, if you will, because there's just going to be a battle later between Yahweh and Pharaoh, or God and Pharaoh, and he is the beast man of sin. But that is how Yahweh does things, because he's got to save that child. So that child is going to end up being born right under Pharaoh's nose, because Pharaoh's not looking for it, but the satanic mystery is always, he knows the times and the seasons. So that satanic mystery is looking for this mystery here. But Yahweh Elohim, in all his divine intelligence and wisdom, he is hiding Moses right under the nose of the one that is looking for him. Okay, read on.
And she called his name Moses.
So he called him Moses, and Moses just means to draw out. Read on.
And she said, because I drew him out of the water.
Because she drew him out of the water. Read on.
And it came to pass in those days, mm-hmm, when Moses was grown.
Okay, so Moses is going to be grown, and he's going to go and look upon his brethren. And he's going to go out the first day, or go ahead and read it, because I don't want to crucify it.
And when Moses was grown, mm-hmm, that he went out unto his brethren, mm-hmm, and looked on their burdens. And he spied an Egyptian smiting an Hebrew, one of his brethren.
So an Egyptian is smiting, beating to the point of death, one of his brethren. Read on.
He looked this way, mm-hmm, and that way.
So he looks this way and he looks that way. Read on.
And when he saw that there was no man, mm-hmm, he slew the Egyptian.
So he's going to kill the Egyptian or slay him. Read on. And bury him in the sand.
And hid him in the sand.
Mm-hmm.
And when he went out the second day.
Now he's going to go out the second day. Read on.
Behold, two men of the Hebrews strove together.
Mm-hmm.
And he said to him that did the wrong, wherefore smitest thou thy fellow?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, who made thee a prince and a judge over us?
Mm-hmm.
Intendest thou to kill me as thou killest the Egyptian?
Mm-hmm.
And Moses feared and said, surely this thing is known.
So Moses knows that this is known. He knows that it's going to become gossip, the top of the town. He's going to be looked for. He knows people. So what Moses is going to do is he's going to flee out into the land of Midian. And when he's out here, he's going to be out here for some 40 years. So at this point down here, when he flees, he's 40. When he's coming to this point where he's about to meet the creator of the universe at the burning bush, he is 80 years old. Now that's what I want you to pick up right there. So just go to Exodus 3:1.
Exodus 3:1.
Mm-hmm.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law.
So Moses, this is the setup, okay? So Moses is keeping the flock of his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. Now let's just run that real quick, okay? Because Moses is a shepherd. Now we said, and we didn't get it, but it's John 5:39. But all of the scriptures are going to testify and point over to Yahshua the Messiah. So you have a shepherd and his sheep, which is going to be pointing to Yahshua, which is the true shepherd, and then he has sheep as well. Now, this is his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. Yahshua is the father-in-law, and he's the true high priest. So you're running types and shadows in the law and in the testimony. Read on. Where you are.
The priest of Midian, mm-hmm, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert.
So he's going to lead the flock, and you see him here, to the backside of the desert. Read on.
And came to the mountain of Elohim.
So he's coming to the mountain of Elohim, which is Mount Sinai, which is even to Horeb. Read
yep.
on.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him.
The angel of Yahweh, or the angel of, you're reading out of the King James.
I'm sorry,
right?
So automatic. The angel of the Lord.
That's right, that's okay. So we've got here in this bush, you're going to hear some titles, and that's where we're going to just kind of draw some attention to that, okay? So you've got the angel of the Lord, read on.
Appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt.
Okay, so we're going to stop right there. We're just going to deal with that. I'm going to erase this for now, and then we'll write it back up. You had it, Tim? Did you have that those scriptures?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good. Okay. So go back to where you started at 3 and 1, where it said the angel appeared.
3 and 2. Yeah. And the angel of the Lord.
Okay, so we have in the bush the angel of, how do they spell it, Tim? Tell me exactly how they spell it.
The capital Lord. L.
How do they spell the? Is it capital T or is it little?
Oh,
T?
The is little.
It's little?
Yeah.
Okay. Of the, okay.
Lord, all in caps.
It's all in caps, okay. All right. And then what else does it say after the angel of the Lord appeared?
Out of the midst of a fire in a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Now, he's making good points. So the bush is burning with fire, but the bush is not being consumed. Or the bush is burning with fire, but it's a vision. It's not being burnt up. Read on.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside to see this great sight.
So Moses says, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burning. Yep. Read on.
4. And when the Lord saw that he turned.
So the Lord, and how do you spell that?
That's all caps, L-O-R-D.
All right. So the Lord saw, okay.
That he turned aside to see God. Called unto him out of the midst of the bush.
How do you spell God?
Capital G, small o, small d.
Okay. So the Lord saw and then God called?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What does it say after that? God called.
Unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, here am I.
All right. So what we're saying is we're saying that the Creator's name is Yahweh. That the Word or Son is Elohim, and that the Holy Spirit is Yahshua. But how do you know you're not just coming in here and then we're just changing something around? How do you know that? You know, there should be proof for what we're saying. You know, if I could just tell you, oh yeah, well, just call him Yahweh. That's not what we have to do. We have to prove that. So if you get, let's start here, okay, real quick. Get, do you have the Bible that shows where King James took? You guys have that Bible? Because if you don't, I do. Okay, I'll get it for you. We'll start here, and there's other stuff too. Malachi, right here. Can you read me that little fly leaf right there? So what, he's reading out of a King James Version Bible. And in that Bible, King James, when he translated the Bible and also transliterated the Bible, but when he translated the Bible, he saw these four Hebrew characters. And when he saw them, Yod, Hey, Wah, Hey, also called the Tetragrammaton, what he did was he put in the Lord. And when he saw Aleph, Aleph, Lamed, Hey, Mem. It's been a while, sorry. And they read from right to left. We read from left to right. So when he saw these four Hebrew characters, King James and his scribes, they put in God, okay? Now, when they saw this name here, which this is the English translation, but they actually saw Yod-Heh-Shin-Hayin, or Shin-Ayin, which is the Hebrew. So when they saw this, they put in Jesus or Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to not just tell you that. I want you to see that. So he's reading out of the King James Version where they told you that they did that. Okay? So, and I'll show it to him. But go ahead and get that little fly leaf and tell me what you've got in there.
Okay, this is a summary of the Old Testament revelation of deity.
Mm-hmm.
God is revealed in the Old Testament through his names as follows.
Mm-hmm.
We have the primary class, and the English form is God, capital G, small o, small d. We have Lord, all capitals, and then Lord with just a capital L and small ORD. The Hebrew equivalent of God.
So can you, okay, so you're reading across?
Yeah.
And okay, go ahead.
The Hebrew equivalent of God is El.
Okay, so what he's seeing is he's seeing this. He's seeing a little fly leaf, okay? And it's showing that what they saw in the Hebrew and then what they replaced it with in the English, okay? So God, you said, was E-L?
Yep, L.
Uh-huh.
Or Elah, E-L-A-H.
All right.
Or Elohim.
Or Elohim. All right.
Lord, all capitals.
Mm-hmm.
Jehovah. Or truly Yahweh. But Hebrew equivalent says Jehovah.
That's so funny.
Yeah, okay. It is.
That in that one, in my other one, it actually says the, but that's a different one. But that's okay. That's mm-hmm. okay. We'll get there. Uh-huh.
And then the lesser Lord would be Adon or Adonai.
Is it spelled with an I or a Y?
A-D-O-N-A-I.
All right. Adonai. Now, let's just stop there for a second, okay? Now, when Moses was speaking to the creator of the universe, was he speaking in English?
No.
Was he speaking in Japanese? I'm trying to make a point, honestly. Was he speaking in Japanese?
No.
Was he speaking Korean?
No.
So what language did the Creator speak to Moses in? We already read it. Go to Exodus 2:1 so we can hear the nationality and also the language of this person here.
Exodus 2:1.
Mm-hmm.
And there went a man of the house of Levi mm-hmm. and took to wife a daughter of Levi.
Mm-hmm.
And the woman conceived and bare a son.
So they're of the house of Levi. Does it say anywhere that they're Hebrew? Does it say that? Did we read that?
That would be back in 1.
It was in 1?
Yeah.
If you can find it, Tim, get it. But my point is that he was Hebrew. So if the Creator is going to speak to him, he's not going to speak to him in English. He has to be able to communicate with him in the language that he was in. So when you look at the language that Moses spoke, he spoke Hebrew. So when King James, you've got it?
1:15.
Okay.
And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives.
The Hebrew midwives. And those were the ones that were protecting the Hebrew children. And Moses was one of the ones that was under the death decree. So they're Hebrew. They are not English. And that's important. Look, the Creator is universal. He's infinite. He's immaculate. He's not worried about that. But in order to understand what is going on with the true name and title of the Creator, you've got to understand what language that they were dealing with. So here, when you see God, you've got El, Ella, Elohim, Lord, Jehovah, or Yahweh, and we'll get to that, Lord, Adon, or Adonai. And there's so much in just that. But I want to see that so we can show Chad what we're looking at. So Chad, I want to show you this. You see this little fly leaf here? Okay, this is the King James Bible. And this here is what I just wrote on the board. It's showing you the Hebrew equivalent and the English equivalent. That they took those original Hebrew name and title out, the original Hebrew names and titles out and put in, go ahead. Oh, is that what's going on? Thank you. Thank you. Because I was wondering what that noise was. Put it up there. But do you see that? Can you see it?
Yeah, this is the English form. That's what they would say in Hebrew.
Exactly. But that was original. Do you understand what I'm saying? So when King James is taking, he's taking the original Hebrew out And then he's replacing it with
the English form.
The English form. So everything, and you can keep that if you want to, but everything that we've been taught has been a lie. It has been a lie, okay? And in order to get to the truth, which is John 4:24, which is how we worship Yahweh in spirit and in truth, we've got to get to the truth, okay? So go ahead and get the tetragrammaton and get the letter J.
Tetragrammaton.
Mm-hmm.
The four Hebrew letters.
All right, you just said it right there. Because tetragrammaton is four, this is four letter word. Tetra, there was a game called Tetris. You take four little cubes and you put them together and you keep putting cubes together and you don't want to get out. Tetra, tetra is four. So this is Greek. Tetra is four, gram is letter, ton is word.
Mm-hmm.
Four Hebrew word, or four letter word, sorry. Four letter word. Okay, go ahead.
The four Hebrew letters usually transliterated.
So this right here is the tetragrammaton. These are the four Hebrew letters. And he's saying usually transliterated as
YHWH.
Now, they say YHWH. Read on.
Or JHVH.
Or JHVH. Is that all you got?
In parentheses, it says Yahweh or Jehovah.
Now, it's saying in the dictionary, not any of our literature, that it's Yahweh or Jehovah. Now, if you go back to the original Hebrew letters, and these aren't even the original Hebrew letters, I have to say that too, because when you start digging and you do your research, it's actually backward F's, but they're still pronounced this way. This is actually the modern Hebrew form. So here, mm-hmm. This letter right here is called a yod. So that yod transliterates into our English as a Y, okay? Then you have the hey here that transliterates into our English language as an H. You have the woo, so it's a wa. That transliterates into our language as a W, and the hey transliterates as an H. So you have YHWH. Now, in the dictionary, they're saying, but it could be J-H-V-H. Now, we have to stop right there, and let's look up the letter J.
J, where'd you go, J? Sorry for the delay.
That's okay.
All right, J, mm-hmm. The letter J.
Mm-hmm.
Around 1000 BC.
Now we're reading about the letter J. And what they're saying is about 1000 BC, or 1000 years before the birth of Yahshua, actually. But 1000 years before this point here. Okay, so that's where we're starting. 1000 years before what?
The Phoenicians and other Semites of Syria and Palestine, mm-hmm. began to use a graphic sign in the form, as you were mentioning, the backward F.
The backward F, yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, and I'll just kind of, it's like, just kind of like this, kind of looks like that. That's the form that the Phoenicians are using back then. Okay, read on.
They gave it the name Yod.
Now, they give this name, it's a Yod. So we're reading about the letter J. And in the history of the letter J, The first thing they're talking about is yod. You understand what I'm saying? I'm overemphasizing. I don't think you're dumb. I'm just overemphasizing to get the point across. It's not a j, it's a y. Okay? So we're talking about the J-H-V-H. So the Phoenicians began to use this sign, and they gave it the name yod, meaning hand. And read it, Tim. Read it. Just how it is.
Meaning hand.
Read on.
And used it for a semi-consonant Y.
Now, they use it for a semi-consonant. Now, if you know anything about the English language, a Y is a semi-consonant. It can be a hard Y, or it can be a vowel. So it can be like synonym is like a vowel. But if you have yod, it's like a hard Y. So it can be, even in the alphabet, that Y has the power of being what it will to be, a vowel or a consonant. So read what you read again.
They gave it the name yod, meaning hand, mm-hmm. and used it for a semi-consonant Y.
So they use it for a semi-consonant Y. So in our language, this is this. Okay, read on.
As in English, boy.
As in English, boy or boys.
Right.
Read on.
After 900 BC.
Now, if they started at 1,000, and this time is weird, so I'll try to write it here. You can't really say zero. It confuses me. I'll do it like this. Okay. See, I like to do the zero, even though they say it doesn't really work like that, but I like to do it like that. Okay, so I'll just do it in a number line, okay? You have a zero here. So what they're saying is 1,000 years before this point here, this is Yahshua, okay? 1,000 years before that is when they started to use this yod, what we would call a Y. Now, if you go 100 years later, which is 900 years, so it's actually closer to this point here, or 100 years after this point, then they began to use another sign. So go ahead and read what that is.
After 900 BC, mm-hmm. the Greeks borrowed the sign from the Phoenicians, mm-hmm. using at first various singular versions.
So the Greeks borrowed it. Read on.
And then a simplified form.
Mm-hmm. So now they're going to simplify the form. Read on.
They also changed its name to iota.
So at this point, at 900 BC, they change it from yod to iota. That's the Greeks. Iota. That's like a fraternity. Iota. Read on.
And made it stand for their vowel I.
Now they made it stand for their vowel I. So in the English, we don't say iota, we say I. We don't say yod, we say Y. So this is the history of the letter J. Read on.
The Greek form passed unchanged via Etruscan mm-hmm. to the Roman alphabet.
Mm-hmm.
The Romans used the sign both for the vowel I and for the semi-consonant Y,
right.
as in illicit.
Mm-hmm.
Or
yes it.
Yes
yep.
it. Mm-hmm. Okay. When subsequently the need arose to differentiate the two sounds.
Mm-hmm.
An unsystematic habit grew up of adding a tail to the I mm-hmm. for the semi-consonant,
mm-hmm.
as in the late Roman and medieval uncial mm-hmm. and cursive. The distinction was not fully established until the 17th century.
Okay, so what they're saying is 1,600 years after this point here, so 1,600 years after the death, the burial, the resurrection, and ascension of Yahshua, because there was no J from what we're just reading, 1,600 years, that's when they began to use the sign or the J. But read it.
The distinction was not fully established until the 17th century.
So that distinction of that adding that tail was not fully established until when?
17th century.
The 17th century, which is the 1600s. So 1600 years after Yahshua is when they created the J. In all languages. That's mm-hmm. not, that's all languages. Like the dictionary is not just talking about the English. You heard them talk about the Hebrew. You heard them talk about the Greek. They're talking about all languages. The J was not established until the 17th century. Okay? So another, I'm picking on you, okay?
That's all right.
So like if you were to take a book, let's try to find you. Where's the J? Joshua, right? We got to try to find it in here, though.
Look up King James.
Ah, that's a good idea. Let's see. We're trying to find a J. This is a 1611 Bible. And in the 1611 Bible, you will not see a J because it was not fully established. So if you were to read through this whole Bible, that's why we got it, because we want proof. You will not find one J in this whole Bible. This is proof. And I'm trying to find one. Do you guys know where Joshua is? I don't have my glasses. You know where it is? Can you find it, Marta? Marta's going to find it for you. Or George, you want to find it? Whoever. I don't care. Jeremiah, Joshua. Look at the fly leaf.
Now, how would they spell J?
What'd you say?
How would they spell J?
Good question.
They would spell Jesus.
They would spell it I-A-M-E-S or I-E. U.S.
V.
But it depends. Okay. But do you see it? Do you guys, did you find it? Let me find it. Will you find it, Marta? Because we gotta give you proof. I don't want to send you out and you don't understand. We just say Yahweh and why, you know, we're weird. No, we're not weird. We actually do the research. Did you find it yet? Okay. So let me wrap this up. So the reason why I got all that, and she's looking for that. You got it? Perfect. That's perfect. You see it?
Yeah, I saw Yoshua.
Okay, let's show Chad real quick. So this would be a J. You see right here, it's an I. So the whole Bible, so Joshua is not spelled with a J. Jesus is not spelled with a J. Nothing is spelled with a J. It's all spelled with an I or a Y. So I say that to say, when they say in the Tetragrammaton within the dictionary that it could be J-H-V-H, we know that it can't be a J back here. Because we're 1600 years. That's not like... It's not like 2 weeks. You know, that's 1,600 years. Like, I won't live that long. I won't live a fraction of that. So we're 1,600 years past this date. So there's no way that this back here could have been a J. So it's Yahweh. And that's what we're trying to get you to understand, because we want you to take something home with you. You know, I don't want you to ever think that the name or the title, the name is Jesus, or that the Lord, that's the name of the Creator. It's not correct. It's incorrect. So here, this is what Moses was given at the burning bush: Yahweh, Elohim, and also, well, he didn't know this until, but he knew it, but he didn't know it at that point at the bush. It was actually a little long. I'm sorry. I know too much and I'm trying to like pull it back. Look, okay. He knew that the name was Yahweh and that the title was Elohim. And he did actually know that name as well. But go back now and read Exodus 3:1 or wherever you were, and now put the right name in it so we can hear it correctly.
Exodus 3:1.
Mm-hmm.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro.
3:13, wherever it was, where you
13.
Left off.
Well, I left off
3 and 5.
Where you were talking about the angel of Yahweh appeared, that part? Okay. All right. Go ahead.
Exodus 3 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
Exodus 3 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
So the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in the flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. Read on.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire. And
so he looked, and the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not being consumed. Read on.
Was not consumed.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight.
Now he says, I will now turn aside. And he didn't look the other way. He turned aside his thoughts so that he could see that burning bush. Read on.
And see this great sight. Why the bush does not burn.
Why am I seeing this incredible event? Read on.
And when Yahweh saw.
So Yahweh saw.
That he turned aside to see.
That he turned aside to see.
Elohim called unto him.
Elohim called unto him.
Out of the midst of the bush.
Out of the midst of the bush. Read on. And said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Get me Philippians 2 and 9. So when we talk about Yahweh, and I'm summing this up, I'm just finishing this out here. So when we talk about Yahweh, this is not limited to the Lord. The Lord is a man of high rank. That's what it means if you look it up. When we're talking about Yahweh, we're talking about pure spirit. We are talking about pure abstraction. We are talking about pure attributes. Omniscience, omnipotence. When we talk about Yahweh, he is divine intelligence, divine wisdom, divine knowledge, divine love, divine beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. He is all of these attributes. If you were to take this chart and take everything else off it and leave the fiery cloud, that is Yahweh. Yahweh is pure spirit. He's incomprehensible. He's inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. Now, that's a lot, and somebody will have to break that down, but we only have so much time. This Yahweh decides to take on shape and form. When he takes on that shape and form, now he is called Elohim. So he comes out of this abstract state into a super incorporeal anthropomorphic being, or just say a man-like figure. But it's a spiritual figure. So here we have Elohim. And then later he comes down as Yahshua. So this comes down into a physical body. But it was always this. Yahweh comes into shape and form, and he manifests in a physical body. That is the unity of the spirit. That is knowing that Yahweh is Elohim, is Yahshua. That's just a little glimpse of that. So go ahead and get Philippians 2 and 9, and I'll be down.
Philippians 2 and 9.
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore Yahweh hath highly exalted him, mm-hmm. and given him a name which is above every name,
mm-hmm.
that at the name of Yahshua every knee should bow of things in heaven,
right.
and things in earth and things under the earth.
So every knee is going to bow to that name. And we didn't get it in Exodus, but it says his name is a memorial or a remembrance unto all generations. And every knee, look, right in your right in your body, which is a Bible, every knee is going to bow, elbow, every knee is going to bow to elbow. Look, both of these bend. You understand what I'm saying? Like I'm saying, even in your physical body, you have witnesses. Every knee is going to bow to L. Every knee is going to bow to your L, elbow. You get it? Understand what I'm saying? Anyway, all I'm saying is that name of Yahshua the Messiah is the most important gift that you could ever have in your whole life. You start there, it will get you anywhere you gotta go. And with that, I'll say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Anwar. Our next speaker for today will be Dr. David Underwood.
Good evening. Just go ahead and go down eventually here in the King James Version, Exodus 3 and 13. And I want it out of the King James Version. And then, Tim, you, Janice, you have it out of King James? All right, Tim has it out of King James. And then I'm going to want you to go over to Psalms 68 and 4. And Janice, I think you can translate that. If not, Tim, I want you to get it too. And then I want where it talks about, thou shalt call me no more Baali. All right? So, is it beyond a shadow of a doubt a name's important? I mean, I got a payday today. And if it went to Tim McNamara, he would be happy, and I'd be fighting payroll. Right? And if I had to pay rent, and I made it out to the landlord would be on my front doorstep saying, my name is, put it on the check. Make sense? So a name is important. That cannot quite be stressed enough. The name of Yahweh, the title Elohim, and the name Yahshua. There is so much more you can get out of them than just saying Yahweh. I mean, there's the assembly of Yahweh. And I'm sure the assembly of Yahweh can go in and give their research of why the name is Yahweh. You can actually go to the Jehovah Witness, and they, the divine name that will endure forever, this is their publication, they can go in and prove that the name is Yahweh. They do an excellent job of proving the name of Yahweh, but do they bow and say, I'm sorry, Jehovah is not his true name? They want to say, well, you know, it's the more common name that people are familiar with. That's an excuse. It's a poor, lame excuse. They know the name is Yahweh. It's right in their pamphlet. The divine name that will endure forever. And he did say his name will what? Endure forever. Pretty simple. All right, so Tim, I want you to go ahead and get then the verse that I asked you to get out of the King James. And Janice, I want you to also get it in the Holy Name as well. I know you're going to have about five fingers in a scripture. That's fine. So please, go ahead.
Exodus 3 and 13.
Now, follow along if you have a Bible at home or in here. Just follow along. So what does it read?
This is the King James Version.
Now remember, this is Moses having this phenomenal experience out here at this. I'm just going to go over here because this is showing Moses, right? Yep. Moses, 80 years old. This is showing him right here, 80 years old. He's having an experience. Go ahead.
Exodus 3 and 13. And Moses said unto God.
Now listen, Moses said unto God.
Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel.
God.
And shall say unto them.
God.
The God of your fathers.
God of your fathers, God.
Has sent me unto you.
Has sent me unto you. So in other words, here it is. the experience here in the wilderness of Sinai, the fathers of Moses are down here in the land of Egypt, his lineage, please.
And they shall say to me.
And these people down here have enough sense to ask, what?
What is his name?
What is his name? Because Moses is being commissioned to go back down into the land of Egypt here and tell his brethren that God has sent me. Right? That's what the story is. Now, let me ask you this. What does it say next?
What shall I say unto them?
What shall I say unto them? God, what shall I say unto them? Have you got the whole point? You know what the point that I'm trying to get. Read it.
And God said unto Moses, I am that
I
am.
Go back up.
Okay, and Moses said unto God.
Yes.
Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name?
Did he read that before?
What shall I say unto them?
Did he read that part? He did?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I missed it. And that's what everybody does. They miss it. God, if God's your name, God, why am I still calling you God if God is not a name? Make sense? So God is not a name. God is not a name. So what shall I say unto them? Do we lose the battery? Yeah.
It's still green.
Sorry.
Could be maybe the volume's not up. Okay, so here we are. This is the experience. Please read, grab the King James Version.
14. And God said unto Moses.
And God said unto Moses.
I am that I am.
I am that I am. Now, I'm going to go in two places. Now, I'll go over here. This is good enough. I am that I am. And I'm sure if, you know what's fun? At times, you just want to kill a little time. Go into a Bible bookstore and start looking at Bibles. And go to this Exodus 3 and 13 and find out what they have in the footnotes or the margins of the translators, wherever it is in their Bible, and see what they say. Because I'm telling you, everybody that has gone into the cemetery to get their theological degree, they know that the name is Yahweh. Hands down. Hands down. So, please read. I am that I am. Now, in the Holy Name Bible, it will be Eyah, Asher, Eyah. Mm-hmm. And we can see it in big letters all the way over here on what we call the two mysteries chart. Because, see, there's a vision. Mm-hmm. And the Eyah, Asher, Eyah, meaning I will be what I will to be, it could be a revelation, life, and righteousness to one. And that same vision can be a delusion, death, and iniquity to another. Please.
And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you.
I will be, will continue.
And God said moreover unto Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers.
Now this is the King James Version. The all cap Lord.
Yep.
Correct?
Yep.
The Lord what?
God.
The capital G, little O-D.
Correct.
Has what?
Of your fathers.
So you're going to tell Moses, your people back here, you're going to tell them that the Lord God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, what?
The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me unto
See,
you.
See, has sent you down here. That's what you're going to tell them. Now, you know what? I want you to go up to the first verse of 4.
4:1. And Moses answered and said, but behold, they will not believe me.
Oh! The people aren't going to believe me. And why not?
Nor hearken unto my voice.
And they're not going to listen to what I say. See, you know, remember, it's been 80 years removed from down here. This is some old folks that are down there. And you know what? Youngins, they don't listen. Right? You heard of the word youngins, right? That's a southern term. I think it is. Youngins.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Continue.
For they will say, the Lord hath not appeared unto thee.
See, the Lord hath not appeared unto you. See, he appeared to Abraham, didn't he? Didn't he appear to Isaac and Jacob? Please.
And the Lord said unto him, what is that in thine hand?
Now, you know what? Here's God asking Moses, what's that in your hand? Now, what you have to understand is the Creator can be what He wills to be. Isn't that what we're reading right over here? I will to be this rod. Correct? And what happens now?
And the Lord said unto him, what is that in thine hand? And he said, a rod.
It's a rod. Folks, what's in my hand?
A pointer.
A pointer. A rod. Please.
And he said, cast it on the ground.
Well, we're going to cast it on the ground. Now, what do you expect it to be? And everybody can see it. Camera person. What I threw down into this chair, has it changed? But in this story, there has been a what?
Change.
A change. Showing forth, I will to be what I will to be. Moses is confident that that staff, that rod that is his hand, is a rod in his hand. And you couldn't convince him otherwise. Could you? Please.
And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent.
Hold it. Do you think that's something Moses would have anticipated? Here it is. Moses, he cast it on the ground. Didn't he? The rod. It became a serpent. It didn't come as a garter snake. And that just rubs me when people say, well, the snake in the garden. Call him a serpent because he's deadly. All right? So here it is, please.
And Moses fled from before it.
Oh, isn't that the normal reaction?
Mm.
I mean, Moses was, I bet you, startled out of his own wits to see a rod that he was confident is a rod changed into a serpent. Please.
And the Lord said unto Moses.
Now here's the Lord. Now hopefully you people will listen and start translating in your own mind when you hear Lord, what should you put?
Yahweh.
That's the connection that you got to start doing yourself.
Mm-hmm.
When you hear See, Lord, you should be putting Yahweh there. And when you see God, you should be putting Elohim there. And when you see Jesus, you should be translating it Yahshua. That's what should be done in your mind to a point where when you read Lord in the book, it's like when people who are Hebrew read the Tetragrammaton and they say Adonai, you translate Lord Yahweh. You translate Jesus as being
Yahshua.
See how you're going to have to get it straight? So now,
going back to the beginning.
Go back to the beginning. Now, let's go ahead and go real quick over to Psalms 68 and 4, and then get Proverbs 30, I think it is, and around 4. And then we still want about Balai.
Got it.
You got them?
Yep.
Now, read them out of the King James Version or translate into, because we still want to make the point. I think everybody in here has been convinced. I think everybody in here. I don't know who's out there.
Psalms.
We're just adding a little more on top. Please read. Where are you reading?
Psalm 68 and 4.
So here we are in Psalm 68 and 4. Let me say this. I want you to think about it. When this event basically took place, it was 1,490 years before this one called Yahshua came into the earth plane. True or false? 1,490 years, is that basically 490 years before this event took place here? The building of Solomon's temple. And let me ask you this. In what language did Yahweh tell him to write it in? Was there a Hebrew language at that time? Was it a Semitic language? Did he write it in Greek? Did he write it in Egyptian? Something to think about. What language did Yahweh give him to? Or did he just give him a spoken language with nothing? Because there are some languages that are spoken that's not written, right? Pig Latin. All right, continue. Psalm 68 and 4.
Sing unto God.
Now, we're going to sing unto God. Sing unto God. That's what the children of Israel did when they came across the Red Sea. Mm-hmm. Didn't they sing? They sang a song. Sing unto God.
Sing praises to his name.
Hold it. If God was his name, why would you call God by a name if God is his name? God, when I go back to the children of Israel, God, what am I going to tell them your name is, God, if God's the name? And you know what? I'm just going to tell you straight up. Elohim goes in there in 3 and 13 of the Holy Name Bible. Mm-hmm. Elohim is a title. In Psalm 16, 4, sing unto Elohim. Sing praises to his name, or Yah, please.
Extol him who writeth upon the heavens by his name, Jah, and
now,
rejoice
there
before
it
him.
Has in the King James Version, and when you go into the Bible bookstore, start looking at footnotes, come to Psalm 68 and 4, and you will see J-A-H, J-A-H. Now, if there is no letter J, as a previous speaker said, no J in Hebrew, no J in Greek, no J in Aramaic, no J in Latin, and it's a Y, how would you pronounce Y-A-H? Yeah. Just knock you over the head a few times. All right. So now, anything else right there? Now, we're going to go over to let's try Proverbs 30 and 4, King James.
Proverbs 30 and 4.
Then we're going to get the where it is about Balaam.
Mm-hmm. Who has ascended up into heaven
now,
or descended?
Who's gone up, and I'm just going to do it this way. Who has gone up into heaven
or descended
or came down?
Who hath gathered the wind in his fists?
Hold it. Is that incomprehensible? That's incomprehensible to grab the wind in the fist. Please.
Who hath bound the waters in a garment?
No, who has bound the waters? And did Yahweh bound the waters back here at the divided waters of the Red Sea? Didn't Yahweh bound the waters here and then let the floodgates open?
Third day.
He had all those waters above in the firmament. And he had all those waters beneath the firmament. And he just let them. And if you weren't in the ark of safety, what was your end? And how many souls entered that ark? That's not a lot of folk. But there's hope. Continue.
Who hath established all the ends of the earth?
Now, who has established all the ends of the earth? If he can determine the end from the beginning, I think he has established all the earth. Wouldn't you? Please?
What is his name?
Hold it. What is his name?
And what is his son's name?
And what is his son's name? If I'm an Underwood, could you possibly guess my father's name? Right? Could you guess who my father's name was? So, can you guess who people say is their Savior's, Jesus' father's name? What is his father? What's the father's name of Jesus?
Yeah. Lord.
No.
Lord.
No, really. What is the name of Jesus' father?
Jesus.
I mean, he said he came in his father's name. Oh, he just came in the power and authority of his father. Well, that's true. But you know what? If you're a Jacob's son, then you are the son of who? Right? If you're Yahweh's son, you better have some similarity to the Father. Can you look? You can tell that this yod is the same yod here. Yes or no? You can tell this hey here is the same as this hey here. Extol him who rideth upon the heavens by his name, Yah. That is the Father's name, Yah. And when you go to Matthew 1 and 21, and you go to the center margin of the translator, you will find that the translators put here, Jesus. What? Do you have it? You don't have it. You have a Holy Name Bible. You don't, give them a good study Bible, you study people. No, Danielle, give them your study Bible and show them. Show them. Show. Have them read it. I'm telling you that these people that went to the cemetery to get their DDs or dumb dogs or their theological degrees, they know this. I'm pulling it right out of the books that they penned. So Matthew 1 and 21, center margin of the Bible. Is it there? Please read it as it is. Read the verse and then go to the center margin. You know what? We're pretty slack as Bible study students. We're way behind. You know what? When you go into some classes, they got stacks of books to read from. We don't have a textbook. Oh, give me a pamphlet. Don't. I'm serious. There are some prepared schools and showing the research that was pointed out to us because we didn't know it before we came in here. Please read it. Is your mic on?
Oh, yeah. And she shall bring forth a son.
Now, she is Miriam. And Miriam is a wonderful Babylonian woman.
No, she's Hebrew.
She's a great Egyptian woman. Mm-mm. She's a great Greek woman. She is of the lineage of the Hebrews. Mm-hmm. Please.
And she shall bring forth a son.
Now, a son. A son is going to come in their father's name. Oh, so it must be some resemblance to Joseph. Mm-mm. Wouldn't that be who most people would point to as being the son of Jesus? Is the son of Joseph? Wouldn't Joseph be Jesus' father? That's what I'm saying. My wife is, yes, I misspoke. The point is, Jesus would be attached to Joseph. Miriam and Joseph, right? Wouldn't most people think that? But continue.
And thou shalt call his name Yahshua.
See, no. We have the King James Version.
And thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins.
Now, that's the mission. Save his people. Who are his people?
Hebrews.
The people Israelites. That were all the way back down here in bondage called the Israelites. Now, do you know how to go to the margin of the translator? Is there a letter by the name Jesus?
Yeah.
What's the letter and where does it go?
Well, actually, mine's a number.
It's a number?
It's 3.
It's 3.
And then in the margin, it says actually Savior.
It just says Savior. Mm-hmm. Now, does anybody else have a good study Bible? Well, I've seen it where it says something along the way of, and Jehovah shall save, right? Mm-hmm. Do you have anything in your wonderful study Bible, Dr. Gleason? Do you? You don't have a study Bible with you? That's why it's fun to go in to a Bible bookstore. And look, first of all, to see how, quote unquote, messed up it is. And then when you know what's right, you know how messed up it is. Does that make sense? See, this one, Shua here, part of the name Yah, means salvation. And his mission is to be damnation. His mission is to be salvation. Correct? So literally, Yahweh is salvation. I will be what I will to be. I will to be salvation for those, your people called Israel. And you know what? If it was just limited to those Jews, we would be a ball in lost in high weeds. You understand what I'm saying? That means us, the Gentiles, we would not have had salvation. But thank goodness, Yahweh back here told Abraham, all the nations of the earth will be blessed in your seed, Yahshua. Type in chattel. Abraham's seed came down through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, down through Joseph, and on down. The children of Israel were a type of the seed of Abraham, right? But we need to see the true seed, who is? Yahshua. Make sense? Now, we're going to go ahead and get Psalm, and we're going to go on from that and go over to, I want Baalai, and it's not in Jeremiah, as far as I know.
Jeremiah 23 and 27.
Okay.
Which think to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams. Which
nope, that's not it.
They tell every...
Yes! Is it? Is it? Huh? It's not in Kings. Baalai, Ishai, and Baalai. Here it is. It's this one called the Lord speaking in the King James Version of the Bible. Tina, if you can find it, find it. The Lord is speaking. He's speaking to his people. And he's basically saying to his people, thou shalt not call me no more Baalai. Baalai. Now, what does Baalai mean? My Lord. When you see an I like this at the end, it means my Lord. So why would the Lord be saying to his people, thou shalt not call me my Lord anymore? Why would the Lord, if Lord is his name, be telling his people, you're not going to call me my Lord anymore? But thou shalt call me Ish, I, which means my what? My husband. Now, what you have to remember, and we don't have a lot of time, that Yahweh, when he spoke that law down into their hearing, they said all the words that Yahweh has said, and we will be as disobedient as we want to be. Well, you know what? They should have just said that because that's what their actions were. But they said, all the words that Yahweh has spoke, will we be obedient? And when that took place, it's like, I do. Isn't that what's said in a wedding ceremony? Maybe not so much today. But when someone gets married, you will be obedient. I do. There's a marriage. Yahweh is called Israel's what? Bride. Yahweh is called Israel's husband. And when they went after this golden calf, they went a-whoring after other gods. When they got out here into the wilderness, over here into Canaan's land, they went after the gods of the land. And Yahweh was very pleased with that and said, oh, we love the groves that the pagans worship in, and I know I really worship, have you to do the same thing. That's not what he said. He told him before he even got here, don't you do the ways of those nations, and don't even let the gods of their nations to come off your tongue. Folks, that's just a little bit of proof. Have we stressed enough that, look, Lord and God and Jesus just ain't going to cut it. Now, I want to go over to Exodus 23 and about 20, where Yahweh is talking. I want to add a King James Version. Yahweh's talking to his people. And he's basically warning them. And what does he say? Have you found it yet?
Exodus 23 and 20.
I got it right. Thank you.
Pat, I don't know. We'll see. Back. Behold, ahead. I send an angel before
Hold
thee.
Hold it. I will what?
Send an angel before
send
thee.
Send an angel before you. Now, who's talking?
Yahweh.
The Lord. See, listen, folks. Tim was a Lord person before he came in here. Then he had a little transition period. Well, Lord. Oh, Yahweh. Lord. Yahweh.
Right.
And now he sees Lord. What is the translation?
Right.
It's Yahweh. He does it automatically. And even when you tell him to read Lord, he automatically says Yahweh. And that's what we all need to get. When you see the name Jesus, you need to automatically Yahshua, understanding that it is Yahweh's salvation given unto your soul. Please read it. Hurry.
Behold, I send an angel before thee.
There's a whole story. There's an angel right here. You can come up and look. There's an angel.
Mm-hmm. To keep thee in the way.
Hold it. You know how people are. They want to go this way. And they want to go this way, and some of the group want to do this, some of the group want to, right? So the angel is there to what?
Keep thee in the way.
Keep them in the way.
And bring thee into the place which I have prepared.
See, Yahweh has prepared this place. You know what? He fed them for 40 years. He gave them light all the time. Their clothes didn't wear out. Their sandals didn't wear out. But this wasn't their end destination. It was really Canaan's land, which is a type of heaven. But what else?
Beware of him and obey his voice.
Hold it. This angel has a voice and beware of him. Why?
Provoke him not.
Don't provoke him.
For he will not pardon your transgressions.
And?
For my name is in him.
Now, what was the name in that angel?
Yahshua.
And there's a whole story about who appeared to Moses, because an angel was back here and appeared to Moses. There was an angel that appeared to Moses down here in the tent. There was an angel that appeared to Moses out here in this tent. There was an angel that was a fiery cloud. It was the angel that was the light down here in the land of Egypt. Folks, have you heard that story yet? Come back. There's more to talk about. And hopefully something was said was edifying to the body of Yahshua the Messiah. And again, it's just touched the surface. But take away the name of Yahweh, the title Elohim, and most of all, that name of Yahshua is important to your soul's salvation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Underwood. That brings a close to our class for this evening. Are there any comments or questions? Indeed, it was a good class. Chad, I would like to thank you again for coming. It was an honor and a pleasure to have you here. Announcements are as follows. Classes are held every Wednesday and Friday from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. and Sundays 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. All workshops are held the first four Sundays of each month, and they begin at 9 a.m. And our after-class question and answer period is the third Friday of each month. That concludes our announcements for this evening. Let us all rise for the doxology so that we may be dismissed. I will be quoting the last two verses of the book of Jude from the Holy Name Bible. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Sing this song. Children sang that song of till that day just can't be too soon. Oh, Yahshua, no one loves me better than you. You, 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 you. Oh, Yahshua, no one loves me better than you. You, 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 you. Oh, Yahshua, no one loves me better than you. You can hear, and when he answers, his voice dispels all fear. When I need him, he knows it right away, and I must confess I need him every day. When I'm happy, he's every reason that I can smile, and I can get so misty when I think on how he died. But if he hadn't done it, no, there'd be no joy, you see. I know that only his blood could atone for me. When I'm angry, his disposition will take control, and he can call me the lullaby to soothe my soul. When I'm crying for fear that I won't pass the test, he says, just keep the faith and let me do the rest. When I feel helpless and feeling sorry for myself, you know he scolds me, then lifts me up like no one else. When I'm tired, 'cause the rhythm of life has slowed my feet, Yahshua is all the inspiration that I need. Children sing that song of victory. Well, I sing this song for free. And like the children sing that song of victory. Well, I sing this song. Better than you.